Everybody, we're back. This is Dave Vellante. I'm with Wikibon.org, and this is theCUBE, SiliconANGLE's production of VMworld 2013. This is our fourth year here at VMworld. 2 years, 2010 and this year, at the Moscone Center. We got this great setup that VMware provided for us. It's just awesome. We're going wall to wall, 3 days. Looks like we might even be going tomorrow. So if you're around, you couldn't get on theCUBE during the first 3 days, I think we're going to be here and add an extra day. Sean Wiedege is here. Sean is the CTO of the Global Enterprise Solutions business at Rackspace. He's been on theCUBE before. Sean, good to see you again.
Dave, great to be back.
So last time we talked to you was May. We had you on at EMC World, actually. And so I know you've been doing a lot of traveling since, but give us the update. You know, what's new since we last talked?
Man, there is a lot going on. So obviously, you know, continuing to build momentum around OpenStack, the community. We've had some great new partners jump on board there. Have some really impressive customer wins in terms of helping customers to be able to deploy OpenStack. So that's been big. You know, we're out here at VMworld this week really talking about what we're doing on our VMware platform. So even though OpenStack's a big piece of our business, we still have a huge installation of VMware infrastructure for customers. So, you know, it's a split message. You know, different workloads, pick the right solution for the workloads, but both of those are really going strong for us right now.
Well, you guys have always been sort of, you know, driven by what the customer wants, right? So if the customer says, okay, this is really the infrastructure that we want to go with, you know, you've been receptive to that anyway.
Absolutely. Certain applications are need the capabilities that VMware brings to the table. Certain applications are much better inclined to be using the OpenStack product set. So we have that flexibility, we have the hybrid model still that we're able to fit the right solution to the customer's infrastructure needs.
It's interesting right now to see the shifts that are going on in the industry, right? I mean, you know, 4 years ago when we started here, it was, you know, VMware all the time. How much virtualization can you get to? The real imperative to drive, you know, adoption. Now you're seeing, you know, other hypervisors, you know, make some good inroads technically, yep, right? In terms of playing catch up. Probably, you know, clearly still not where VMware is. They had quite a leap. But then you have this OpenStack phenomenon come in. It's interesting to hear some of the positioning that VMware has, that embracing OpenStack, you know, positive to OpenStack. We love OpenStack. There's a but. And the but is, but it's just a framework. It's kind of not ready for prime time. And in all full disclosure, I wrote a couple years ago, OpenStack's not ready for prime time. But the OpenStack Summit began, was to us a milestone. It started to change our view of how ready OpenStack was. So is OpenStack just a framework?
No, OpenStack is not just a framework, and OpenStack is actually ready for prime time. You know, the initial conferences we had, you know, the first conference up in Austin, very small group, but you know, we've gotten some great partners, some great momentum. HP, Red Hat's contributing a lot of code, and this thing is really starting to pick up a lot of traction with customers. We're seeing customers using it for content delivery, seeing customers use it for big data solutions. We had the big announcement with CERN, 15,000 hosts that they're going to manage with OpenStack. So, you know, it's easy to dismiss because it is still a relatively new product, but with the capabilities that we continue to add, the ever-increasing number of sponsors, the increasing amount of code that's going into the product, it's far moving beyond a framework.
You just did a study, and we had one of these sort of, I call them conditioned response questions, and it was just sort of a generic question about their philosophy. And we asked customers, are you willing to essentially trade the risk of lock-in for simplicity and, you know, single vendor and you know, that it's all going to work, you know, nobody ever got fired for buying IBM type of thing. To the other end of the spectrum is we're seeing stuff like OpenStack, and we're not doing business with guys that aren't, you know, dogmatic about open systems. So those are sort of, and then couple in between. And not surprisingly, we found about 15% of the people were on that, we're going OpenStack, you know, route. So the early adopters, which you would expect, and about half the audience said, you know, we're willing to risk that lock-in, because it's safe, I won't get fired, essentially, is what we interpreted that as. And then you had the in-between. Does that sound about right to you?
I think you're spot on. You know, there are the organizations and individuals that are more progressive in terms of their technology adoption. I mean, you know, when we started Rackspace, we started off Linux-centric and very much open source-centric, and there were fewer customers, but over time, Linux has supplanted Microsoft as our largest operating system for our customers. So, you know, the early adopters are where the activity is at now, but we continue to see more and more interactions, more and more interest from more corporate mainstream IT decision makers.
So, what's your take on some of the discourse around OpenStack embracing AWS APIs? You know, you've followed that a little bit, you know. Some have come out and been very vocal about it. Others have said, hey, that's not the right strategy. you know, because essentially then we're relying on Amazon to drive the API strategy. What's the Rackspace, you know, formal take on that?
Yeah, you know, it's a great conversation, and what I really like about the conversation above anything else is it's really the community trying to figure out which direction to go in. And that was really the intent behind OpenStack, make it open source and let the community dictate where the development went. You know, I'm still of the belief that we should not lock ourselves in, we should not adopt someone else's APIs. We then become tied to Amazon very closely. I don't think we need to do that. You know, with the increased emergence of public clouds based on OpenStack, you're going to have a federated capabilities regardless. So stick with the API that we can control, that the community owns, and not lock into somebody else's standards that might limit your flexibility down the road.
Now how about, obviously OpenStack, when the OpenStack Summit, you had some really good customer examples. A lot of those were in cloud service provider space, so that's good. You get early traction there. On the one hand, it's great validation as well. You're getting a very sophisticated audience and a distribution channel that's built right in. So that's all goodness. You know, at the same time, people say, okay, what about mainstream enterprises? So what we're hearing at VMworld is a lot about hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud is an imperative, and really the computing model. And Pat Gelsinger was on earlier, and John called it the hybrid cloud. I think he called it, John, a stepping stone or something, and it was really funny.
Halfway
and
house.
Pat went nuts, halfway house. I was like, what are you talking about? It's not halfway house, it's the end game. And then John clarified that a little bit, but Pat still went a little, you know, like mini ballistic as much as Pat ever does. But what are you seeing as far as hybrid cloud adoption into the enterprise generally, and then specifically with OpenStack? Is that the model that you guys are locking into?
Yeah, we're seeing it. We're seeing the demand from customers. So you're exactly right. Initially it was service provider focused. Service providers looking for ways to create cloud computing delivery mechanisms for their customers. What we're seeing now is we're seeing corporate IT saying, I need to become more agile. I need to be able to be just as flexible, just as responsive to our customers as a public cloud provider. So they are actively looking at OpenStack as being the framework to be able to deploy that. There's a lot of expertise out there. It is open source, so there's a lot of customization. We have all the big name vendors that have joined the organization and are contributing code. So we're seeing more and more it moving from service providers to the corporate IT groups trying to figure out, how do we leverage this to give us more flexibility, but at the same time lower our cost to be able to serve our customers. So it's a big shift. Now the hybrid capability, the idea that we can have federated clouds and you have workload portability, and so I'll choose a medical cloud for one application, I'll choose if I want a high touch provider like a Rackspace, I'll use that for other applications. You know, that vision is still very early, but that's what we see this going. We see where you'll be able to pick and choose your cloud. If it's price that you're making the decision on to test dev, there'll be a cloud to do that. If it's really a service component of availability where you want a Rackspace and our expertise, you'll be able to choose Rackspace. So, you know, the hybrid capability, it continues to expand, and the model's continuing to evolve, but we see that as no one solution is going to meet every customer's needs. And so we continue to invest in the ability to do public and private workloads on OpenStack.
And in terms of how you think about the private cloud, if I infer correctly, you're saying that federated application is a ways off. So today it's a lot of DR and the like. But that is the vision that you see over time taking hold, that federated application.
Absolutely, federated applications and use of different providers for different types of workloads, right? So we continue to have strong interest, particularly international right now with some of the telecoms around, you know, can you help us become a provider? And then at some point, how do we start linking these clouds together to allow customers to be able to serve content in the countries they need, keep data in countries that may have regulatory requirements that say data has to stay in country. So the federated cloud is coming. Our goal is that it speaks OpenStack.
Sean, I got to ask you about the developer angle. Obviously, one of the things that we talk about in theCUBE here is developers, and Rackspace is so pro-developer. We heard that earlier from Rick Jackson, the new CMO, came from VMware. They're the lifeblood of the cloud right now, the communities at OpenStack in particular. You know, what is going on? Because it's an application-centric world, work definition, workloads, that's the new focus, and developers don't want to deal with the underlying hardware. So yeah, okay, pick a cloud, but what technically is going on that's going to accelerate the onboarding of developers?
Yes, it's a great question, and glad you had a chance to meet Rick. Really excited about him coming and joining us from VMware.
Yeah, awesome.
And taking the opportunity with Rackspace. I think he brings a lot to the leadership team. So, you know, developers are critical. We have a number of outreach programs that are going on with developers right now, new SDKs. We have a DevOps blog and capability, so we're really spending a lot of time in terms of developer outreach, because they're really fueling the continued expansion of OpenStack. So, you know, we can't reach out to developers often enough. We have a lot of open houses here. We've now got our San Francisco office, just there this morning, we've got 100 plus people there, and it's heavily developer-centric and heavy on the outreach to the developer community. So, you know, we will continue to those grassroots type efforts. What we're seeing is the last OpenStack Summit, we, as a company, sent over 200 people out there, and the bulk of those were on the development side of the house. And so the attendee list was massive, somewhere in the area of 2,500 people. So it's getting traction with that developer community. The ability to be able to continue to interact with OpenStack will get easier. And you'll still have that flexibility that comes with it being an open source project.
Yeah, well, we'll get to the DevOps question, but I'm looking up some stats that we put together, kind of our own little leaderboard based on market data. Looks like Red Hat leads the commits totally on the OpenStack side. Rackspace number two, and then IBM there. But commits don't always tell the story in terms of being number. You guys founded it and have a huge halo effect from OpenStack. And you guys are transparent about that. So, you know, it's not like you're trying to land grab OpenStack to promote your own agenda, although there is interest. So OpenStack's been very successful. The community that has driven a lot of the cloud early on, especially for you guys, is DevOps. And I like to say that DevOps is the guys who are eating glass, you know, breaking things and just kicking ass and taking names. And ultimately, that's a unique individual kind of profile. The early pioneers that have done the DevOps, we know them, Joyent, Facebook, and Heroku, and all these guys that did cloud early, they had to build it all. It wasn't general purpose software build, and you guys did your own with your own cloud. But when you go to mainstream IT in Iowa, some guy in Iowa, IT shop, they have development needs too, but they want to be DevOps-like. So we kind of came to the conclusion that's a mindset. So with that mindset, what is the new DevOps culture look like for the guys that want to be a DevOps, in the DevOps style?
Yeah,
and develop and just do stuff.
It's funny because we had to make that same transformation ourselves, right? We're very much an infrastructure company originally, taking things off the shelf. The idea, and delivering high level of service, the idea of having to create tools and create products, the developer centric, was very foreign to us. So we're actively in a transformation right now with our internal systems to embrace DevOps, and we're reskilling a lot of our people so that they were traditionally infrastructure. We're finding ways to be able to reskill them so that as we adopt the DevOps mentality and the cloud infrastructure for applications, they don't get left behind. So what we're seeing from that is, because we've had these successes, companies are coming to us and saying, can you show us how you did that? Can you come and meet with our people? Can you tell us your lessons learned? Can you accelerate our path to being DevOps centric and leveraging these types of technologies? So we've actually deployed, we actually have some capabilities now with our professional services team. We're able to go out and talk to customers, help them through this transformation, as well as being able to bring in some of our valued partners to be able to assist in that process. So it's an area that traditional IT is struggling with. They see it coming, and they're looking to us as one of the leaders in that area to be able to come in and assist them.
Yeah, it's interesting, the new developers have this cloud style, we call it yesterday, the cloud style, you know, doing it cloud style, and DevOps style, kind of the same mindset, right? So you know, with that, it's like, okay, what is the cloud style? I mean, we had Rick Jackson compare and contrast the VMware culture to Rackspace. It's like, you know, we used to have quarterly reviews, and he didn't say slow, if I use the word slow, but Rackspace, boom, boom, new releases. Scott Sanchez was telling us they were releasing code every day. It's like raining code, and just like a lot of iteration. That's the agile program model, iterate, iterate, iterate. That's a fast cycle. And that's not always easy for an enterprise. How do you bottle that up and give it to the enterprise? I mean, can you? Is it possible? Are you doing it?
You know, it's funny that you mentioned how fast the things are moving. I took 8 weeks off this summer. We had this great sabbatical program, and I came back, and I had to relearn everything from scratch. It was amazing how much code they were able to push, product enhancements. I mean, it took me 3 weeks once I got back. I felt like I should have been in a rookie training class to learn what we had done over that time period. So it's a very different mentality, and you know, the enterprises are grasping it more on at a team-by-team approach. So take an application, take a small team, start small, and we see that as their successes continue to grow, and they're seeing the benefits of that high-paced continuous improvement, continuous development, deployment. It catches traction with other people throughout the organization that go, you know, we want our team to move that quickly. There's business value in being able to push code out more quickly, and it starts to ignite. So what we've seen is a lot of these places have been more grassroots efforts. Now we're starting to see the CTO come in and say, how can you help us do this on a more formal basis?
You know, the change you mentioned is intoxicating at one level. It's opportunity for for smart people, but also if you make a misstep, you can get blown away. I mean, just an example of you going on vacation, you know, there's a moving train, as we've been saying on theCUBE. So with that, I want to ask you kind of a more of a personal and industry question kind of intersected together, and that is, for the folks that have been successful, the winners that you've worked with in the cloud the past 5 years, that have tripped and fallen and gotten up and have done things, obviously yeah, OpenStack's got some successes now, you guys have, what's the winning persona look like? What are the things that winners do that you can point to that others can learn from?
Yeah, the biggest thing is not to be afraid to fail. You know, we have running the public cloud that we have, we've learned a lot of lessons along the way. We've struggled with capabilities, with feature sets, with availability in the early days. You know, that's what led us to go down the path of creating OpenStack and putting it out there. So, you know, the type of people we're looking for now are, you have to bring knowledge, experience, but also be willing to dive into the culture and not be afraid to make a mistake. You know, sometimes it's bitten us. You know, we pushed a code release out here a couple weeks ago that impacted one of our critical internal systems. We were able to recover quickly, but we feel that, we felt the challenges that come with, not just the benefits, but also some of the downside that may come with pushing code that frequently. Yeah. Of course, the system in question, you know, it was a great reminder of how far we've come and how quickly we've come once it wasn't available. But there's definitely some challenges in there. You need the right
mentality. Enterprises can't tolerate downtime, and certainly you guys run your business in the cloud, so you obviously have to recover quickly. You know, it reminds me of the Mark Zuckerberg phrase, break stuff. And it's easy to say, but you know, in an ops-centric, you know, high availability mindset, it's just not an option. So, you know, but that's the difference between a developer and an ops guy. A developer has to push the envelope and recover quickly versus no until you can show me. It's not always that easy to say, show me.
And you got to have a lot of faith in your test plan, right? So we are doing continuous automated testing of our code before they roll out. That's the only way that you're going to be able to do this. We have, you know, was working with a customer recently, they're spinning up and spinning down 15,000 VMs a day on OpenStack, just doing testing of code before it goes into production. So, you know, the platform itself gives you that flexibility and is a bit of a safety net as best you can have in order to, as you're pushing this code through.
So I just have one last question, Sean. When you went on that 8-week sabbatical, did you take a sabbatical from email?
You know, it was a yes.
It was
a forced email sabbatical. So the company gives this great benefit, and when the day you go, they shut off your email. Now, I might have been able to pull some strings and get another week or two of access, but at that point, it died.
That's
and so
awesome.
I had to disconnect.
You're back on Gmail. Send me forward to me.
At that point, I said they didn't want to talk to me. I tried to keep away from it, but I mean, was really excited to get back and get back
just,
into it.
Just to highlight the massive 4, change, messages. We had Josh McKinty on earlier. The CEO of and an OpenStack participant, he was saying just this morning there's a massive threat on containerization going on, and you know, this is as an example just this morning. And these are big community conversations. This isn't like, you know, fight over a pixel here or there. It's like this is serious architecture being done. The engine, the next cylinder, as soon as 6-cylinder, 8-cylinder engine, to use the car analogy, are being discussed. So, you know, the best time to get in is now. Is that accurate?
We're always looking for more people. So, you know, it's a great time to be in there. There's a lot going on. If you want to make an impact and have your voice heard and really shape where this thing goes, absolutely, jump on board.
Okay, so fine, I'll give you the final word here. Give us an update on, for folks out there that might not be in the know, that haven't looked at Rackspace in a couple weeks, maybe 8 weeks or more, a lot of changes. What's new? What should they know about what's going on with Rackspace right now?
Yeah, so great things are going on. Continued focus on OpenStack. Our public cloud capabilities have some great new enhancements that are coming. We've got some great betas that are going on. Spent a lot of time talking to customers about that roadmap. We've also made a significant reinvestment in our VMware offering for customers, so more self-service, more DR capabilities, you know, more control for customers. So really, we continue to work towards a unified capability, making the consumption of IT infrastructure easy for customers, and we'll continue to invest in those areas around self-service and the hybrid capabilities.
Cloud's continuing to push along, software-defined enterprises, cloud, everything's happening, Rackspace leader, you guys are continuing to innovate. What a great journey watching you guys bolt on that cloud, you know, almost 7 years ago, and just start building your own and bringing OpenStack, huge success. I mean, again, I'm such a big fan of what you know, Jim Curry, Lou Mormon, the whole team has done, how they got OpenStack up and running, just great timing on everything, and certainly it's well received, so congratulations. This is theCUBE, we'll be right back with our next guest after this short break. Stay tuned, day 3, coverage continues after this short break.
Going to Disneyland.
Going to Disneyland.
Yeah. I mean, these guys are great. I think this is a revolutionary forum. Up till a few years ago, I'd never seen this in my entire career. These guys are great interviewers. They're spot on, they're sharp, they're funny to work with. And they just ask great questions, so it's a real pleasure to be on theCUBE.
It's really great. What's so neat about it is it's like real-time discussions, and also just being able to have people share their views simultaneously. So I love it. I think it's really fun. It's a great way to, you know, get the message out and to have a dialogue.